Hey everybody, and welcome to session number two of our conversation about Black music in America. My name is Fredara Mariva Hadley. I'm an ethnomusicology professor at the Juilliard School, and I'm excited to be back with you all talking about music in conjunction with the Civil Rights Movement and Black Lives Matter. Before we get super deep into everything, I want to remind us of the framing that we established last week. These are our general guidelines for our conversations about music and Black music in America that we'll be using throughout all five of our sessions. Number one, Black music is an archive of history, reflection, and lived experience. Number two, Black music gathers and shapes Black cultural identities. Number three, Black music advocates for the communities it represents. And number four, Black music is the foundation of American popular music and much of global popular music. All of these points directly tie into what we're talking about today when we're talking about the roles of Black music in moments of heightened movement activity. It's important to note, and I'll talk a bit more about this in a minute, that Black people in the United States are always advocating for their own freedom and equality, but we do have periods in American history where events cause those activities to gain and garner greater attention and the level of activity increases. So these guidelines, when we look at Black music, when we listen to Black music, these principles are always evident in what we're hearing and experiencing. So I also talked about movement, literal movement, geographical movement from one place to another is essential to understanding Black music and its history. You start with the internal migrations of people all over the continent of Africa for various reasons. And then last week we talked about the forced migration of Black people stolen from the coasts of Africa and forced to migrate, forced to move to the Caribbean, South America, and North America. And so this graphic is talking about another migration internal to the United States, the Great Migration. And it's one of the largest internal American migrations in history. It is a migration of Black people that completely transformed the United States when millions of Black people, for various reasons that included fleeing racial oppression in the South, moving north in the hope and promise of greater economic opportunity in northern cities like Detroit, New York, Philadelphia, Boston, Los Angeles, Oakland out west. We had millions of African Americans moving from the South into these various parts of the country, mostly bracketed around World War I and World War II, thinking about the wartime economies, the increased production, industrialization of the United States, and the need that it had, not only for Black people to be enlisted in the armed forces and fight, but to work in the factories, work in the homes, work in the harbors of New York, of the great northern cities. So this map shows us, again, based on where people were in the South, that helped to dictate where they migrated to. The arrows loosely are following train lines and lines of transport out of the South up north. I'm originally from the state of Florida, and so most of my relatives who moved north during the Great Migrations ended up in Newark, New Jersey, and Brooklyn, New York. And so you can see, if you follow the yellow line, it leads from Florida up the East Coast to New York. Lots of my friends are from Chicago, shout out to the Chi. Lots of their families are from Tennessee, Louisiana, Alabama, and Mississippi. And such is the case for folks who ended up in Los Angeles and Oakland, mainly pulling from Texas, Louisiana, and Arkansas. And so people followed the route that was most convenient for them to move north. And they went to northern cities often where they already had relatives living to make the transition more manageable for them. And so one of the most portable aspects of any culture is its music. So of course, as people moved from the South to the North, the music traveled with them. And this is something that we can see in the proliferation of Black music over the last 150, almost 200 years. Again, this is work that was pioneered by ethnomusicologist Portia Maltsby. And you see in this trajectory of sacred music, rural gospel, moving later, you would have transitional styles of gospel and getting into urban styles of gospel around the 1930s and moving forward. And so you see that shifts both in sounds, or I'm telling you, are the shifts of sounds that people carry with them from the South to the North. The same is true if you look at secular traditions. You start out, we have game songs and work songs, field hollers doing enslavement. After the end of enslavement in the late 19th century, you have the rural blues, boogie-woogie, vaudeville blues. Then you see in 1940, urban blues. Blues has moved to Chicago from Mississippi, from the Delta, and then you have a vast proliferation of genres that nod to some regional styles like house, techno, go-go. House and techno, we will be talking about in a couple of weeks with Rich Medina. But you can see the thread of migration even in thinking about the music. Same is true for jazz. You see, we go from syncopated dance music, New Orleans styles jazz, or Dixieland jazz in the late 19th century, early 20th century. And then you start breaking off into these different subgenres of jazz, some of which can be connected to place to specific geographical places like stride piano in Harlem, big bands in Harlem, Chicago, and Kansas City, and moving forward in the trajectory of jazz. And so the movement of Black people, both forced, coerced, and voluntary, is a significant part of how the music of Black people unfolds. So now, we'll talk a little bit about the civil rights era and the important connection between music and civil rights. There are many, but just about every genre of Black music had something to say about the civil rights movement. Very often when we talk about music and the civil rights movement, we understandably think of the freedom singers and we think of movement songs, We Shall Overcome, Woke Up This Morning With My Mind Stayed on Freedom. Activist Fannie Lou Hamer often sang that. And that's a really important canon of music. Alongside that, we had music that was in dialogue with what was happening. Jazz musicians had something to say about what was going on. R&B singers had something to say about what's going on. And so when we're thinking about the relationships between the music and the movements, we want to take the wide angle lens to give ourselves the opportunity to hear as many different interpretations, dialogues, and responses that Black people are having about the moment of change in which they find themselves in the 1950s and the 1960s. I love this picture from the Civil Rights March on Washington for Freedom and Jobs, the 1963 March on Washington. I always like to add the part for freedom and jobs, where Martin Luther King gave his I Have a Dream speech, because it just shows us everyday people. And so much of what the civil rights movement was and Black Lives Matter movement is everyday people trying to advocate in their own ways and their own lives to push for the equality and the recognition of the humanity of Black people. But when we think about the civil rights movement, one of the reasons we bracket it off in thinking about the 1950s and the 1960s in particular is because we did have some significant legislation that was signed during that time period. And not that legislation is the only means by which Black people are able to advocate for themselves and guarantee rights for themselves, but it is an important lever in the freedom struggle. So in the 1950s, you had Brown versus the Board of Education, which said that schools should be desegregated and open the door, although it would take quite some time for Black students and white students to go to the same schools. And we also know in the 21st century that schools and many school districts are just as segregated as they were in the 1950s. But you also had the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and of 1968. And these acts help to transform how we see America. These are the pieces of legislation that outlawed separate but equal, that meant that there could be no more discrimination in public facilities. There could be no more colored water fountains and white water fountains. These pieces of legislation said it was not legal for people to face housing segregation, redlining practices, be denied renting a house, buying a house because of the color of their skin. These are the pieces of legislation that address those fundamental attacks on Black livelihood and Black humanity. And we can certainly and should discuss the pitfalls and the shortfalls of those pieces of legislation. But at the time, this is what Black people, many, were advocating for and pushing for in order to improve the quality of their daily life and their access to certain aspects of American society. Now, when we think about music of the Civil Rights Movement, many people don't think of jazz first. But I love the We Insist Freedom Now suite written by Max Roach, Abby Lincoln, and Oscar Brown. And it was written in 1960 in anticipation of the recognition of the centennial of the Emancipation Proclamation, which was issued by Abraham Lincoln on January 1, 1863. If you saw the album cover, it is them sitting at a lunch counter paying homage to the lunch counter sit-ins that were happening in North Carolina, in Greensboro, North Carolina, protesting the segregation of lunch counters where Black people could not be served food sitting next to white patrons. And it's important, I want to point that out for another reason, because so much of what was happening in the Civil Rights Movement, as is true today, was led by young people, children, high school students, college students, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Student is the very first word in that organization. And so we should be inspired by what young people have been and continue to accomplish on behalf of human rights and civil rights in particular. And so they wrote this piece, and it includes, the whole album is just a stunning meditation on the existence and sort of the place of Black people in American society. And as a matter of fact, global society, in that they also have include pieces like All Africa and Tears for Johannesburg. And so they're also thinking about, in a pan-Africanist lens, thinking about the oppression of Black people globally, not just in the United States. But in this piece, Freedom Day, which is just a striking piece of music in which Abby Lincoln sings vocals, Max Roach said about it in 2001, he said he wasn't really able to finish it. And he says, and I quote, "Oh yeah, we fought. We could never finish this piece. It still isn't finished because we don't really understand what it is to really be free. The last song we did, Freedom Day," which I'll play an excerpt from now, "ended with a question mark." And so when you hear this piece and you hear Abby Lincoln singing and you'll hear the conclusion of the piece, the cadence isn't fully resolved, because it represents that restlessness that Max Roach is alluding to. He doesn't, in 1960, and apparently still in 2001 before, in this interview before he passed, he still wasn't convinced that African Americans had been allotted the freedom that this country's founding document ensures them. And so this is an example of a piece of music that isn't necessarily participatory, something you would hear at rallies, but it is indicative of how jazz musicians, this piece, I'm thinking about Charles Mingus's Fables of Faubus, which was a treatise addressed to the governor of Arkansas who fought the desegregation of his high school, so much so that the president had to send in the National Guard so 9 Black children could go to a formerly all-white school. This is a struggle that isn't solely located in the South, but is on the minds of African Americans of various stations in life, various socioeconomic levels, various genres of music, and one that they feel compelled to address in the ways that feel most organic for them. And so you'll hear Freedom Day, I'll play a little bit of it when Abby Lincoln is singing. Pay close attention to her lyrics and how they would resonate, one, with the original context of what this piece was meant to address, and that is the emancipation of enslaved peoples in the 1965, after the Civil War, but also at the dawning and sort of in the midst of the churning of the Civil Rights Movement.
Flying must be lying, can it really be? Can't conceive it, don't believe it, but that's what they say. Slave no longer, this is Freedom Day. Freedom Day, Freedom Day. Throw those
note the tempo and the energy and the fire in this performance, the excitement that they're conjuring and thinking about what Freedom Day must have meant to enslaved people. But in her final note, you hear that tension remains. It isn't fully resolved because questions linger about what freedom or to what degree America will allow formerly enslaved Black people to be free. In the next example, this gets us closer to the music that we generally think about when we think about the Civil Rights Movement. And it's Mahalia Jackson singing a Negro spiritual, Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho, at a rally in 1966 where Martin Luther King was in Chicago gathering people to fight some of the conditions of urban poverty in New York, in Chicago. And one of the things that I think is important, there are lots of things that I think are important about this performance, but one is a callback to Negro spirituals. We spent a lot of time last week tracing the lineage of Swing Low Sweet Chariot from the 19th century into the 21st century. But again, you hear these songs that were so much about pushing for one's own freedom from literal enslavement being used again to buoy the spirit, to rally people and fortify their spirits and their souls to advocate for the next step in freedom. So if enslavement ended in the 19th century, what Jim Crow and that whole era represented a whole other 100 years, almost exactly, of racial oppression, racial terrorism in the United States. And so if you're thinking about the kinds of marches and protests that so many people were involved in the 1950s and the 1960s, they may have been nonviolent in their own actions, but they understood that what they were courting was violence against them. They knew that their nonviolence would be met with violence. And that has to take some type of, you know, groundedness in one's spirit to be able to face dogs, hoses, being thrown in jail, possible death in the name of fighting for civil rights. And so it's well known that Mahalia Jackson was one of Martin Luther King's favorite singers. She often would sing to him privately to encourage him. She would sing before he spoke. She sang before he spoke at the March on Washington for Freedom and Jobs in 1963. She performed benefit concerts in order to raise money for the movement and his organization, the SCLC. And so in this moment, you watch the temperament of Martin Luther King as Mahalia Jackson begins to sing, and watch how the congregation, all of those gathered there, fall into the song as Mahalia Jackson leads it as only she can. And she brings back this Negro spiritual that's been a part of the community for so long and makes it contemporary to the moment in which they're advocating for freedom yet again. Mahalia Jackson is all Mahalia Jackson, but not the central figure. She understands her role here as the song leader among a community of people. Oh, And King, who starts this video looking pensive, by this point, has even broken down into a smile. And this is an incredibly young man, maybe 35, 36 years old. And listen to what Martin Luther King says about Mahalia Jackson.
I think I can say concerning this great gospel singer in our midst, our dear friend, my great friend Mahalia Jackson, that a voice like this comes only once in a millennium. If there is any doubt in anybody's mind concerning whether we have a movement here in Chicago, you ought to be in this church tonight.
And in his commentary on Mahalia Jackson and directly linking that to the movement, I think we can interpret that as a statement on the importance of music in the movement itself. The Freedom Singers were so essential because they sang songs, if you think about we shall overcome someday, songs like that, that people could sing as they were marching to encourage themselves, to build up their courage, their strength as they faced just overwhelming and daunting odds. It's been said that the movement might not have happened had there not been song. And that is how essential this music, all of the genres we discussed, but particularly those freedom songs, those Negro spirituals, were to fortifying people for the difficult work that lie ahead. The last example comes from Motor City, Motown, Detroit. Martha Reeves and the Vandellas dancing in the streets in 1964. And this song went to number 2 on the Billboard Hot 100. That's the top music chart in the country. And so it has lived on as one of Motown's seminal hit songs. And so the song was everywhere, immensely popular with both black and white audiences. And as catchy as it is and as groovy as it is, and you could listen to the song and not think too deeply about the lyrics and really enjoy it as they're shouting out different cities all around the country. But yet and still for Martha Reeves, it still held this deep connection for her and connection to black people's inability to truly be free. In an interview in 2019, she said, "We couldn't stand on the street corners and sing because there was a police unit called the Big Four. It was usually 4 big white men, and they had clubs and guns. And if they caught a group of black people standing on the corner singing doo-wop, as we had a tendency to do, they would jump out of the car and attack you, arrest you, or run you home. Run you to your house because they didn't want blacks gathering. So dancing in the street was all of that to me." And so the genre she references, doo-wop, was a form of harmonized vocal singing. And this was a tradition that goes back to the 19th century where black folks would get together for their own entertainment, amusement, and start singing together and harmonizing together. It's related to the tradition of gospel quartet singing, which became really popular in the 1940s and 50s. We listened to an example of that last week as well. And so she's saying, there was no freedom to just gather and have fun, hang out with your friends. That constant presence of surveillance and the constant threat of violence was so much a part of their lives as young people. The constant threat of violence from police was so much a part of their lives. And again, this extends to the 19th century and the periods of enslavement, where we had black codes and all kinds of practices that were meant to disrupt any attempt that black people had of just gathering themselves together. There is a fear of black autonomy, Black Gathering. There's all kinds of codes and practices that say there can be no more than two or three Black people gathering together because people were afraid and white residents were afraid of insurrection, understandably so, and some form of racial retaliation even after enslavement ends. And so many of the police practices that we still have issues with today have these historical precedents. And even in a song like Dancing in the Streets, Martha Reeves is thinking about the reality of what it's like to be a young person in the quote unquote promised land of the North who still isn't allowed to freely gather with friends and literally just sing without the threat of disproportionate or no violence was warranted in those situations, but without the fear of surveillance and retaliation and violence against her and her friends. So I wanted to play this little clip of Dancing in the Streets, particularly where she's shouting out the different cities, because in this early 60s, this is also the period in which we had racial uprisings in places like Watts, Harlem, Detroit, in response to police brutality against Black citizens. And she says about her singing on that song, and I quote, she says, "I was singing bright, I was singing happy, and my soul and my spirit are all in that recording." And so it's popular to say things like Black joy as resistance, but when we remember the ominous reality of her life, that gathering together to sing with her friends could bring upon violence, right? It is literal. Singing joy as resistance. It is this song which is so infectious and so up-tempo and so fun. It still has these roots and has this meditation on the darker side of the reality of life for so many people of African descent in the United States. So I wanted to show those three examples because I think they're really different, but they show just begin to give us some diversity in terms of how musicians are reckoning with the civil rights era and the events that are happening around them, how they're using it to directly connect and inspire people to continue to advocate for change, how they are recognizing both the past, especially in the Max Roach example and in the Mahalia Jackson example. You have those antecedents, those previous genres which show up again, or previous events which show up again. And Freedom Day, Max Roach is thinking about, and Abby Lincoln are thinking about Emancipation Day 100 years prior and trying to figure out, has Freedom Day actually arrived for Black people? And then in Mahalia Jackson's Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho, she's drawing on the theology that enslaved people adopted for themselves, which said that God is Jesus is on the side of the oppressed, or as Howard Thurman would say, the theologian Howard Thurman would say, the disinherited, and they use the language of the Bible to justify, right, their push and their cause for freedom. And then you have Martha Reeves and the Vandellas making a really great dance tune, which is calling for unity, which is calling for fun, but at the same time is recognizing that this isn't the reality for everybody of African descent. So with that, we'll shift to the 21st century and thinking about Black Lives Matter. I hope that we started to think through some of the recurring issues and themes that people are still addressing, the questions of police brutality, the questions of racial targeting remain with us both from the 19th century to to the 20th century, and into the 21st century. And just like the civil rights era, the musical responses and dialogues to the moment have been diverse and all equally important. I'd like to start with the first one, which is Kendrick Scott's 2016 piece, Philando. And he wrote this in response to the murder of Philando Castile in Falcon Heights, Minnesota, on February 6, 2016. Philando Castile, for those who may not know or remember, was a black man who was in the passenger seat of his car. His girlfriend, Diamond Reynolds, was the driver, and Diamond's young daughter was in the back seat. When they were pulled over, he did what the law requires, and he informed the officer that he did have a gun in the car and he was licensed to carry it. Yet and still, despite the fact that he was the driver and no crime had been committed, Philando Castile was killed by that officer as his girlfriend and her young daughter were in the car. Diamond Reynolds streamed the events as they unfolded to Facebook, and so the world could see what was happening as it happened in Minnesota. And Kendrick Scott, the drummer Kendrick Scott, in dialogue with Philando Castile's family, created this piece, Philando, which quite honestly is a powerful and difficult piece to listen to. And in it, he takes the audio from that day and intersperses it with his own composition and builds around Diamond Reynolds' voice. And so I'll play a snippet of it before it builds to the climax, but you'll hear the voice of Diamond Reynolds in this piece, Philando, by Kendrick Scott. And I think this is a really important example of music as both memorial and reckoning and witness. Kendrick Scott's piece here forces us to confront the agony and the pain and all that was stolen and lost in that moment. It's a solo performance on drum with audio. And again, the voice you will hear is that of Diamond Reynolds as the event happened. And so the piece builds and tells the story of that event. And about this piece, Kendrick Scott says, I wanted to create a story out of that moment of chaos. What Diamond Reynolds and her daughter endured in that moment is unimaginable. The loss is incalculable. But in this piece, Kendrick Scott sets it in a way that compels us to face it and to be honest about what happened in that moment, even if other entities will not be honest about what happened in that moment. The music stands as an important record and a testament to the pain and the loss of that moment. Another example, getting us back to the notion of movement music, music that is actually used in the context of protests, rallies, and marches, comes from a song that was released by Kendrick Lamar in 2015. His song, All Right, the beginning of that song, the chorus of that song, We Gonna Be All Right, ends up being adopted by the people as their own call to justice and freedom. And so we'll listen to a snippet of Kendrick Lamar's studio version of All Right, and then how it was used in a protest in Cleveland, Ohio.
All's my life I has to fight. All's my life I hard times like yeah, bad trips like yeah. Nazareth, I'm f***ed up, homie, you f***ed up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Huh? We gon' be
the beginning of the song, all my life I had to fight. It's true for the reality of black people in this country, but, you know, comes from the film The Color Purple, and is a cultural quotation in the beginning. And then he goes into this affirmation, God got us, we gonna be all right. And so that's a powerful affirmation just in someone's individual life. But it became particularly important to people as they moved into the streets, a calling for accountability of the deaths of people like Tamir Rice in Cleveland, Sandra Bland in Texas, Eric Garner in New York City, and countless others. And so this is an example of how the people themselves choose the songs that will lead them through their fight for justice. And you'll hear them chanting, taking that cry from Kendrick Lamar's All Right and making it a chant that they literally use in the streets as they're advocating for justice. And one of the things that I think is important to point out too is the indestructible presence of hope in all of these things. Despite the experience that people of African descent have had in the United States, there is this constant theme of hope, right? You hear it literally in this chant, we're gonna be all right, it's gonna work out. We don't know how, we don't know when, but it's gonna work out. We hear it in Mahalia Jackson singing Joshua Fifth, the Battle of Jericho, in which she says, the lyrics of that song, Joshua Fifth, the Battle of Jericho, draw on a biblical story in which the children of Israel in the Bible are fighting a seemingly impossible battle, and yet they end up victorious. And so people genuinely believe that if they agitate enough, if they push enough, that things can and will get better. And we have seen that those steps of progress do come, but not without consistent, sustained agitation and the accountability and the powers that be, the politicians that be, being consistently held accountable for their actions. And so I think that theme, even in the Freedom Day meditation, yes, it ends on attention, but it is acknowledging the possibility that a full emancipation is possible, perhaps even imminent. And so as we listen to these different genres and we listen to these different performances, it is a constant theme, not present in every single moment, but there are really dark days. And we hear that in the Philando Castile piece as well, right? And so there's this call for honesty, but there's this consistent rebounding in hope. And I think that thread needs to be looked at and thought of not in a dismissive way, not in a way that assumes that people are naive, but I think about what James Baldwin talked about and when he said he sees himself as an optimist because what is the alternative, right? And so when we listen to African American music or the music of African Americans, that constant sense of the belief, perhaps in this country, but in the ability of the people to affect real and genuine change for themselves is something that we hear as a consistent refrain. I want to wrap today by talking about a little bit about Kirk Franklin's Lift Every, well, not Kirk Franklin's Lift Every Voice and Sing, but the song Lift Every Voice and Sing. Lift Every Voice and Sing is thought of as the Black National Anthem, the Negro National Anthem. It was written by James Weldon Johnson and his brother, Rosamond Johnson. James Weldon Johnson wrote the lyrics in 1900, and his brother wrote the tune in 1905. It was written as a tribute to Abraham Lincoln's birthday for a school program in Jacksonville, Florida, for a program in Jacksonville, Florida. And over time, the NAACP really rallied around the song and helped, and that's how it kind of made it into the ether as the Black National Anthem. That's the beginning of it anyway, of how that began to happen. And the song itself is a hymn. It's written in hymn form, verse and chorus. And it's a song, even though it was written at the beginning of the 20th century, you still hear in many different contexts today. If you are at any program on the campus of a historically black college, of which there are over 100 in the United States, you will hear the Star Spangled Banner, which is the national anthem of the United States of America. And that will be followed by Lift Every Voice and Sing. At many African-American churches, at various programs, you will hear Lift Every Voice and Sing. I think Lift Every Voice and Sing is included in every hymnal of every African-American denomination, Christian denomination in the United States. And so this is a song that has repeatedly found its home with successive generations and been rearranged in many different ways. By gifted arrangers like Roland Carter, by pop singers like Melba Moore in the 1980s. It's had many, many different lives. And so on July 4th of 2020, the gospel singer and the gospel songwriter and musician Kirk Franklin released his own interpretation of Lift Every Voice and Sing. And in doing that on July 4th, it was a callback to me of Frederick Douglass' famous speech, What to the Slave is a Fourth of July, which he gave in 1852. In that speech, he says, I say it with a sad sense of the disparity between us. I am not included within the pale of this glorious anniversary of the Declaration of Independence. Your independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us, us being white Americans and enslaved black people at that time. He was very, very conscious that the Declaration of Independence, this country's founding documents, did not address the freedom of enslaved people. And so Kirk Franklin releasing this on July 4th, and this is after the murder of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, I believe, had been murdered by this point. And this uprising of activity against police brutality, against racial profiling by white citizens in the United States, he drops this on Independence Day. He doesn't do a version of the Star Spangled Banner, but he does Lift Every Voice and Sing as an affirmation of the nationhood and the push for freedom of African Americans within the United States of America. I also want to point out that before this, on May 31st of 2020, many of you know about the popular versus battles that Swiss Beats and Timbaland have put together, where they bring together two powerhouse musicians or artists to go through their discography. On May 31st, they brought together Kirk Franklin, another great gospel singer and songwriter, Fred Hammond, to give us a versus of healing, if you will. And so in that versus, they played their gospel discographies as a way to give the watchers and listeners some sense of hope, some sense of reprieve. But during that verses, Ahmaud Arbery's mother, Wanda Cooper, actually called in and thanked both the organizers and all of the people around the country and those in Brunswick, Georgia, where Ahmaud Arbery was killed, for literally running while black, for support, for agitation, for activism. And she said that alongside her faith has sustained her. And so here again, you find gospel music in direct dialogue with what's happening in the community in which it exists, the black community in which it exists. So this arrangement of Lift Every Voice and Sing takes the standard hymn and its piano and a gospel ensemble, but he adds a tag at the end that really emphasizes the end of the verse. The first verse of Lift Every Voice and Sing that says, let us march on till victory is won. And so you see how he leans more deeply into the gospel, his gospel bag towards the end, to utilize both rhythm and repetition to really emphasize and fortify it, much in the same way that Mahalia emphasized and so sang so spiritedly Joshua fit the battle of Jericho, to encourage people to continue to march on, to be in the streets, to rally, to agitate for justice and for freedom. And so this is a really powerful performance, and I want you to pay attention to the posture of the singers at the conclusion of the performance. And so we'll watch it all the way through from the beginning to end. This is just the first verse of Lift Every Voice and Sing, of which there are three verses.
Thank you. like this part right here. Come on. Something to it. Just encourage you. We're gonna take you to church later. Let's go.
We'll keep marching right until the victory is won.
To all my brothers out there.
Hold your head up, brother, till the victory is won.
To all my sisters in the struggle.
Keep believing, sisters, till the victory is won.
Till that day.
Till that day comes.
Hey.
Let us march on.
To victory.
Till victory.
I'd like to close today with a quote from Imani Perry in her most excellent book, May We Forever Stand, A History of the Black National Anthem, which is all about Lift Every Voice and Sing. And she says, and I quote, "The ritual community, that deliberate meaning-making and learning, that repetition, meditation, and fellow feeling, that epic story, that sense of courage, inspiration, promise, and resilience, that love and beauty that once sustained Black struggle in song, we need them now just as much as we did in 1900. May they, may we forever stand," end quote. Thank you. Now we're gonna get into your questions. We good? All right. Somebody had a question about my family shirt. So, I am trying to be a little bit on theme with what I wear. And yes, this is a shirt from a protest in Tallahassee, Florida, led by students of Florida A&M University in the 1960s. Florida A&M University, FAMU, is a historically Black college in Tallahassee, Florida. It also happens to be my alma mater. I'm a very, very proud FAMU alumna. Shout out to all the Rattlers. This shirt was a gift, and so I can't really tell you where I got it, but somebody who knew me very well got it for me. All right, so good question. So someone is asking if I could say something about the possible tensions between Black music and struggle against the prevailing unjust structures on the one hand, and the fact that musical production and distribution institutions often are a part of those prevailing structures on the other. That's absolutely true. Where to begin? The history of Black music on the industry side is a history of marginalization. We start out with minstrelsy. It always goes back to the period of enslavement. So we start out with minstrelsy, where America's first popular music is one that is built on caricatures of Black people, Black song, and Black life, right? And that's the foundation of the American popular music industry. And so none of that ever really goes away. It changes names, it may become more milder, there may be more trinkets, but none of that ever really, really goes away. And so by the time we're talking about this period of the 1950s and the 1960s, we're still, even today, in a de facto race record world. And what race records were, the music industry had like three buckets: the country and Western bucket, the pop music bucket, and the race record bucket. And country and Western was rural, white music, right? And then the pop music was urbane, white music. And then race music was whatever music Black people made and went into that category, with the assumption that nobody wants to hear Black music but Black people. And so what that meant very often was Black music by Black artists was not promoted in the same way. You had this whole history in the 1950s where Black artists were putting out records and the record label would put a white face on the album cover or no face at all to try and hide the fact that the artist was black. And so black musicians, and you know, there are countless stories of this, not only had to fight the racial oppression that existed in the world, but the same racial oppression that existed in the world also existed in record labels. And so that factors in so many different ways, from who gets signed, what the expectation, the kinds of deals that black artists are offered, the kinds of promotion they often don't get, right? The expectations of the kind of music you are going to make as a black artist. This is something that Prince, when he came into Warner Brothers in the record industry at the age of 18, already knows the deal and is fighting against. I can't tell you how many times I've read in articles in different places, you know, Usher, the R&B singer Usher referred to as a rapper, or some other R&B singer referred to as a rapper, because the assumption that if you are black and you're making music, you must be a hip hop artist, is so baked into how we see music, or euphemisms like urban music, right? Which seek to sort of push it away from both blackness, and also urban isn't necessarily a genre. That's not necessarily a sound. That's not necessarily a music. And so absolutely, black artists are fighting on both fronts, all throughout the civil rights movement and into the present. And it's it makes the success of labels like Motown, which had its own internal issues, but the success of that label and what they were able to accomplish, all the more extraordinary. Berry Gordy had a keen sense for how to promote black artists and legitimate R&B music, right? But he also understood what we might now call the respectability politics of the day. And so all of the musicians and singers were immaculately groomed. They studied with etiquette coaches. They, you know, had choreographers to really, in a lot of ways, make them seem like every other young white teenager in the country and less threatening. All of those are code words for how black people are often policed in performance, right? And very often black musicians and artists preemptively, especially with thinking about historically, try to thwart those efforts or anticipate that kind of resistance. Only, I think that's one of the huge victories of hip hop, in that hip hop really upsets a lot of those norms. And so, yeah, that's a very, very real issue. Just issues in pay, issues in having bad deals, and so not getting the royalties that they deserve. All of those issues are ones that have plagued black musicians throughout the existence of the American music industry. That's absolutely, they were fighting on dual fronts, is what I would say. All right. I was wondering about the gospel quartet tradition's role in activism and civil rights. Much of what I hear is biblical in nature, not necessarily overtly activist. I was hoping you could expound on the relationship between the gospel quartet tradition, activists and artists in the civil rights era, and also perhaps talk about the relationship between explicitly non-Christian black activists and the centrality of Christianity and songs during that period. Oh, okay. Again, that could be a whole other session too. But on the subject of Christianity, the theologian James Cone would come along in the 20th century and give a name to it and call it black liberation theology. And many other theologians and preachers espouse similar views. But basically what that means is, from the second Great Awakenings in the 19th century and the mass adoption of Christianity by enslaved black people, you see this theological orientation that sees Christianity and God as one of liberty and freedom, right? And so when we're thinking about gospel's role in the civil rights movement and what protest or music of affirmation is, it needn't be explicitly political in terms of how we may read those lyrics. because a lot of that is already baked into the biblical allusions that they choose to include in their music. So again, going back to Mahalia Jackson and Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho. And so that is a song that is from the perspective of those who are pushing for their freedom. And so if you listen to it, there's nothing inherently activist or political about it, but that's already been brought into the theology and the interpretation of Christianity that Black people are practicing. And so it's no coincidence that so many of the freedom fighters and the people who led uprisings during enslavement were also deeply, deeply religious and Christian, whether you're talking about Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, Denmark Vesey, Nat Turner. All of these people were deeply Christian and grounded in their faith, but one that saw their faith as a portal to freedom, not just in the afterworld, but in this world as well. And so I think that's really important. And so the quartet tradition and singing those same songs, and I think setting also matters, where they were singing them, right? If it was at a rally, if it was just at a church, if it was at a concert. And when we think about what Martha Reeves is pointing to, just the gathering of Black people could be cause for violence against them. I think that broadens our scope of what activism has to look like in people's lives. It isn't just activism when Martin Luther King shows up or Malcolm X is present or A. Philip Randolph or whomever, Bayard Rustin, but it is all of the small acts and the commitment to living your life anyway that really gives us a scope of how people are pushing back against a racist and oppressive system in a really broad sense. Now, to your other question, people who were decidedly non-Christian. And so that begins, even when we think about Frederick Douglass, he makes a break where his advocacy for abolition makes a turn, a more of a secular turn, right? And so you have that during the civil rights movement as well. Not everybody is, you know, meeting at the church house and grounded in Christianity in that particular kind of way. And so I think that's why looking at jazz, looking at R&B, looking at rock and folk and these other genres as well are important in giving us a broader lens into how different people of African descent from different positions in society are also thinking about freedom as well. Thank you for that question. I think this is our last question. In the video of Martha Reeves and the Vandellas dancing in the streets, we see them singing among white people. How so? Did white people understand what it meant, or did they only enjoy the music not knowing its meaning? So I was thinking about that video in particular. I need to double check. I think that video might have been from a performance in Europe. I'm not absolutely sure. But you did have this segregation again, even in the pop culture realm, right? So shows like American Bandstand did not have many, if any, Black dancers in that teenage dance show. The Black musicians you would see were the Black musicians who were there to perform. And this was also a long history in Black music as well. Black artists having to perform for white audiences or segregated audiences, and you had artists who would make decisions whether they were going to continue to do that or not. And so I don't know that they necessarily knew all of what Martha Reeves was bringing to that song. The song absolutely works on a level. If you just like it and you want to dance and you enjoy it, it works. But there may have been people who understood what she was bringing, the depth of her own lived experience that she was bringing to that song. I say the same is true with things like Beyonce's Homecoming. You can watch her Coachella performance from a couple of years ago and just enjoy it and not understand all of the references she's making to historically Black colleges and to different aspects of Black culture. That knowledge isn't necessary, but I think it is important to remember that very often that's conscientiously being baked in to what is happening musically. And again, that extends all the way back to Negro spirituals, where many spirituals could work on that dual level. people could hear the song and sing along and not know that it meant that we're about to run away. But the message was for who the message was for. And so, you know, when we're looking at that, those layers of meaning, and that'll come up again when we sit down with Rich Medina and talk about sampling, how those layers of meaning get baked in is also an important aspect of thinking about Black music as well. All right, so can't believe we're out of time, but thank you so much for tuning in again today for session two. I look forward to seeing you all for session three next week, where we talk about music from the Civil Rights Movement coming up into the present. Take care, y'all.